It's Mock Monday, and we have 4 rounds of action today, and also with some trades, so get ready. It's going to be some shocking ones, I think. I will say, but let's get flying into this thing, and I'm not talking about Daytona either, even though those cars are flying right now. On to number one, Caleb Williams, self-explanatory. This one is either you trade down, you keep Justin Fields, or you select the quarterback that you want, whether it's Caleb Williams, Drake May, or even Jaden Daniels. Hey, J.J. McCarthy, you never know. Jim Harbaugh said, don't be surprised he's the first quarterback taken off the board. Washington Commanders, Drake May, quarterback, North Carolina. This is another one where Cliff Kingsbury might want to go ahead and say, let's get a little bit more dynamicism. Let's go Jaden Daniels. Don't be shocked. But for me, Drake May is the number two quarterback. And I mean, you could even make the argument he's the number one quarterback. Next pick, Marvin Marvelous Harrison Jr., the wide receiver from the Ohio State University, the most talented player arguably in this draft. And for the New England Patriots, I would rather just say, let's go get that blue chip wide receiver prospect that I almost feel like is can't miss, barring some injuries and etc. He is such a good playmaker, and this team needs help rather than selecting QB number 3. Not to say Jaden Daniels is a bad prospect by any standards, but there isn't, you know, there are some things that we need to go over more that I think Jaden Daniels doesn't always get critiqued on. You know, so those things to me, Marvin Harrison Jr. is a phenomenal prospect, and he gives me that blue chip grade. On to the Arizona Cardinals. I'm going with like a good neighbor. We're taking Malik Nabers, LSU receiver. They need a good, well, Kyler Murray needs a good, I don't know, I'm talking with the accent now, but Kyler Murray needs a good playmaker, a good neighbor to have, and I think Malik Nabers is a very, very good receiver prospect, and it's very, very close between him and Marvin Harrison Jr., but Malik Nabers comes into this receiving core and gives him a more electric juice and a number one target. On to the LA Chargers here, and I'm taking Joe Alt, self-explanatory here. You go get yourself a right tackle to pair along with Rashawn Slater to have a bookend tackle duo that can be phenomenal here for Jim Harbaugh and to build those trenches. You know he wants to. And oh, the trade alerts are coming on the phone right now. Joe Shane making a deal. And Schneider's like, hey, Shane, let's pull up a trade because we have a quarterback prospect. We've hit on a lot of draft picks over the past couple of drafts. So we want to take a chance on a quarterback of the future behind Geno Smith for a season or two. And that is going to be Jaden Daniels. They do have to give up a first rounder next year and a third rounder this year. But that is to come up to take the Uber upside of Jaden Daniels. As I talked about, he can sit for a little bit behind Geno Smith. This is a perfect scenario for him to come and learn. Then we go on to the Tennessee Titans. And they are going to be taking Olufashanu, left tackle. Another one that it's pretty self-explanatory. They need a book. They need a tackle. Just any tackle. And on to Leiatu Latu here for the Atlanta Falcons. Look, quarterback Jaden Daniels off the board. That's okay. Look, I think we can still figure it out, man. Maybe at the end of the first round, we can trade up. Or the second round, we have options. We have the meats. But anyway, this is another one that there could be a free agent quarterback too. Maybe Kirk Cousins ends up over here into Atlanta. Multiple options. We're still going to be looking at the quarterback position, though, later in the draft. But Leiatu Latu, the best pass rusher in this draft class. Day one impact. I see him as an Aiden Hutchinson type of prospect. On to the Chicago Bears, Rome Odunze. He's going to bring out the Roman Coliseum back over here, bring into the Chicago Bears and Soldier Field. Rome Odunze gives Caleb Williams a great 1-2 pairing with him and DJ Moore. Number 10, Amarius Mims, right tackle Georgia, comes over here for the New York Jets. And this is another way, please, as a Jets fan, get offensive line help. And Amarius Mims is an absolute monster, man. I think he's a top 10 player in this draft. And I think it's closer between him and Joe Alt and Olufashanu than people give credit for with Amarius Mims. Uber talented. On to the Minnesota Vikings, Dallas Turner, going a edge rusher prospect here in Dallas Turner, because I felt like interior defensive line could be an option too for this team. We'll see what they do in free agency if Danielle Hunter doesn't come back, if they bring back Kirk Cousins, which by the sounds of it, they are trying to bring him back, which in turn may make it tougher to bring back your edge rusher and Danielle Hunter. So with that being said, maybe they go off the edge here with Dallas Turner. On to number 12, Bo Nix. Bo Knows is coming to Denver. This is one of those schematical fits that just everyone's going to be talking about, and for good reason. Bo Nix, timing quarterback, and for Sean Payton, he expects his quarterbacks to be able to, you know, get through the progressions quick and hit the check down if need be, or, you know, hit the offense and what Sean Payton wants. And I think Bo Nix can do that at a high level. And on to our next trade alert. The Miami Dolphins are going to be moving up with the Las Vegas Raiders. And a little bit of a shocking move. This one, I was like, this was just like a spur of the moment thing while I was going through the draft. And I'm like, this one does kind of seem a little wild here. But we got the Dolphin Blue on here today. And I am going to be taking Brock Bowers. We do have to give up our second round pick for the Raiders, who are looking to acquire more talent. And for this Dolphins team, it's like, we're going all in, man. We want to build a Super Bowl team. We're going to throw everything that we can at this for another season. Brock Bowers, Super Bowers, as I like to call him, comes in here, gives this offense even more juice into this room with Tyreek Hill and Jalen Waddle. Now you have in Brock Bowers. Number 14, we're going J.C. Latham. Gotham Latham comes over here and ends up being the right tackle of the future. Could play guard early on if Ryan Ramczyk is still good to go. And hey, if nothing else, Latham can even compete at the left tackle position, even possibly with Trevor Penning. Maybe move Penning inside a guard. Then we go on to Jerzon. Here's Johnny Newton to the Indianapolis Colts. They could end up losing a big one if they lose Grover Stewart, which would be a monster loss. But if they do lose him, even if they don't lose him, I still think they could use some more help for the future, because you got to think that they need to think about DeForest Buckner for the future as well, going into last year of his contract. So you get Johnny Newton into that interior defensive line, at least for a rotational basis early, and then long-term defensive tackle position, which is such a big thing for Chris Ballard in that defensive line. On to Talese Fulaga. After the Giants traded down from number 6, they get an offensive lineman, right guard slash right tackle. And he's going to compete with Evan Neal. Whoever wins that job, look, best man wins the right tackle job, and then you put the other guy over at right guard. Hopefully you just have great competition, and you're building yourself a good offensive line for Daniel Jones. And then you also have a first rounder next year to combat the fact that if Daniel Jones isn't good, then boom, you go after one of those quarterbacks, because you have ammunition, plus you're probably picking top 10 to select a Shador Sanders, a Quinn Ewers, etc. On to the Jacksonville Jaguars. We're going Brian Thomas. Self-explanatory, I go with it every week. I'm sorry, Jaguars fans, but on to the Cincinnati Bengals. Hopefully you didn't see that. Don't look. Anyway, on to the Cincinnati Bengals. Tyler Guyton, an Oklahoma tackle. I'm getting ahead of myself with the clicker, but yeah, boom, pop, 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 beep. Anyway, Tyler Guyton's going to be the selection here for the Cincinnati Bengals. Another one that's pretty self-explanatory. Jonah Williams hitting free agency. We'll see if he's back or not, but either which way, they need to improve this offensive line and protect your quarterback. Time after time. I can't sing, but on to Jared Verse here, as you kind of saw, but anyway, spoilers, this was a pretty self-explanatory pick anyway. Jared Verse would be that elite pass rush to pair along with Byron Young off the edge. And as I got some voice cracks going on too, I don't know what's happening today, but Jared Verse, a really good prospect, just falls because of other positional needs on other teams, but he's a really good player. On to the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I'm going center prospect. You know, Arthur Smith, he wants a good center, man. That's a big priority. There's offensive line. Jackson Powers Johnson, and what a name as well. Powers Johnson. I can't even fit on my own slide here, but that's how dope of a name it is. Beastly center. You put him right in there. Upgrade from Mason Cole. Self-explanatory. Terrion Arnold. After the trade down for the Raiders, we're going to go get a cornerback that is uber versatile, can play everywhere in your defense, but I think he can stick on the outside. You got Nate Hobbs in the slot. We'll see what happens with, you know, Armeek Robinson. You got Jack Jones, who was playing, you know, was balling out at the end of the season. Armeek Robinson stepped up, but now you have more competition in it. Just kind of, you know, iron. I'm going to use that one again. Iron sharpens iron. You have an elite cornerback room now with Terrion Arnold that can be this team's number one, and you got some dudes that can definitely play with, you know, Jack Jones if he comes back, Armeek Robinson, etc., to go out as that number two corner to go along with Nate Hobbs as well. And then you go on to Cooper DeJean, another self-explanatory pick for the Philadelphia Eagles, but you need a good secondary player, and I think Cooper DeJean could also play safety for this team. So somebody that can give you that slot, outside cornerback, even safety version in Vic Fangio's defense. Just an uber playmaker. Next pick, Byron Murphy for the Houston Texans. They need interior help. You got to figure on, if you don't bring back some help on that interior, like Sheldon Rankins, a free agent, etc., Malik Collins is going to be a free agent in 2025. So they need to get younger and better on the interior. You go ahead, next trade up. Detroit Lions are going to be making a move here with the Dallas Cowboys. And, you know, pretty cheap trade, but, you know, the Dallas Cowboys do pick up a third rounder here at 92, and they have to give up 172 in exchange for that. But The pick is going to be Kool-Aid McHistory. Detroit Lions, go get that elite secondary player. You pair up Alabama secondary with Kool-Aid McHistory and Brian Branch back together again. Woo-hoo! I'm liking it, man. That'd be really fun. And you got yourself a really nice secondary, man. And then on to the Green Bay Packers. Nate Wiggins, cornerback from Clemson. I think he'll fit the new system. With Jeff coming over here on the defense side of the ball from Boston College, playing some man coverage. Nate Wiggins can do that at a high level. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, Troy Fatanu, offensive tackle from Washington, moves inside the guard here at the next level and also gives you some swing tackle capability in a pinch if you need it, but Fatanu gives you that upgrade at the left guard position. They need help on the interior of the offensive line. Arizona Cardinals, next pick, Quinion Mitchell, getting that number one cornerback into this secondary. They play a lot of off-cover quarters, stuff like that, and Quinion Mitchell going to be ideal, even though he showed that he can play at the line at the Senior Bowl, but you know Quinion Mitchell can play in a lot of coverage schemes. Mitchell going to be a beast for this team. Next pick, A.D. Mitchell, wide receiver, Texas Hook'em Horns. You get yourself that number one receiver of the future. He can be the number two early on if Stephon Diggs is back, and he upgrade over Cabe Davis. Kingsley Suamataea, left tackle, right tackle, guard, move him around. Other than center, I would say. But I would say that this dude, you start in at guard, and you can be the long-term right tackle if Terrence Steele's struggling. Give him some competition. He could be the long-term left tackle for Teron Smith. Or you move Tyler Smith over. There's too many Smiths, too many names in my mind. Sorry, but Kingsley Suamataea, you get the boy. You get some offensive line help, right, Dallas Cowboys? Think about the future. The Cowboys have done such a good job at finding future offensive linemen. And as I was mentioning before, Terry Fontenot, they're not done yet. We're getting on the phone. The Atlanta Falcons are calling the Baltimore Ravens. And they are moving up. They are moving up for sure. They're coming up with the Baltimore Ravens. They're giving up pick 43, second rounder, and a pick 74 in the third rounder. In exchange, they get up to pick 30, and they are going to be taking their quarterback of the future, J.J. McCarthy. I actually think he might be a better scheme fit for Zach Robinson in their offense. I'm going to take that chance here with J.J. McCarthy, and I say this with all these guys, really. They're all super talented. It's a matter of coaching, what you put around them. I think this Falcons team, coaching-wise, has had the biggest upgrade out of any team this offseason. I really believe that. I think they are in a phenomenal position with Raheem Morris, not Mostert, and Zach Robinson to be a very good football team. And with the pieces they have around and the drafting, we continue to upgrade Leatu Latu and J.J. McCarthy. You got weapons, and maybe we'll add another weapon here later on. But McCarthy, not super crazy of a price to pay either. You have to give up a third rounder. Ultimately, I think it was a great price to get your quarterback in that five-year contract. And then Ladd McConkey, Georgia wide receiver. A shocking move here. One that you don't, I mean, this was one that I'm like, wait a minute, this might be a good fit. It's a perfect fit, in my opinion, too, for Kyle Shanahan's offense and what he can bring too as a blocker, not to mention just as, you know, with his speed and yak ability, but he has all around that game that I think Kyle Shanahan can fully take advantage of. And you bring him in here for a wide receiving core that might need to get younger, might need to get cheaper, because you got to think that Brandon Ayuk about to get a contract as well. Do you have to move on from Deebo at some point? So it's very much something we need to start thinking about for this 49er team. And I think Ladd McConkey in a five-year cheap deal is going to help them out tremendously in adding more playmakers. On to the Kansas City Chiefs, we're going to add a playmaker in here too, Keon Coleman, receiver, Florida State. And he gives them that size and on the outside to go along with Rashee Rice in the slot. I think this is starting to build something for Patrick Mahomes. Now we go on to round number two and the Carolina Panthers. Offensive line was the best available in my view. Even there's some receivers available, but I feel like let's go ahead and wait because there might still be a good receiver in the third round. I want to make sure we improve the offensive line for Bryce Young. We had in Graham Barden, uber versatile, could probably play center for this team. And that's kind of my vision here is he upgrades Bradley Bozeman, or at least he gets some competition, and you could always cut Bradley Bozeman, save some money too, and go for that route. But Barden gives you guard depth, gives you tackle depth for injuries. Just need a versatile offensive lineman that can play and help Bryce Young on that interior. Michael Penix Jr., next quarterback off the board for the New England Patriots. You got Marvin Harrison Jr., then you take your chance at the quarterback position here at the top of the second. Michael Penix Jr. has got all the talent. It's just, you obviously have the medical red flags, but to me, I think Michael Penix Jr. is just as good and maybe the one of the best throwers in this class, purely as a thrower. Maybe doesn't have that crazy athleticism or, you know, dual threat capability, but dude can still move anyway. On to Devondre Sweat here, interior defensive line, hook 'em horns. We go back to Texas and the Arizona Cardinals. They need interior defensive line help, so they go get a nice space eater run defender to help them out tremendously on the interior. Chop, chop, chop. This one was just, I don't know how he falls. He fell in this draft again. Chop Robinson to the Commanders. A dream has come true for Dan Campbell and this defense. He gets his Micah Parsons, maybe, right? And then we go on to Kamari Lassner, and the Bolts are going to be taking a cornerback on the outside, getting younger, and you pair him along with Asante Samuel Jr. in that outside cornerback room. Next pick, Troy Franklin. Deep speed, a separator, especially deep. Troy Franklin, much needed presence for this Tennessee Titans receiving core. Next pick here for the New York Giants, Darius Robinson, uber athletic edge rusher with immense talent, 34 inch arms, can play on the interior. And that's my kind of my envision, is he ends up replacing Leonard Williams, the big cat there who went over to Seattle, or at least give him something there on that interior in that presence mold, because I think he can play it like a five tech, can play off the edge. You can move him around, shuffle him. And I ultimately like the upgrade with Darius Robinson here. Jordan Morgan, Morgan and Morgan is going to be coming over to Washington. So they get themselves some help on the interior of the offensive line early on as the left guard. And he could be the long-term left tackle for this team too, because I think he can play tackle at the NFL level. So you put him in at left guard early on, and then it gives you some flexibility for Charles Leno in the future, or slash injuries in general. Next pick for the Green Bay Packers, we're going Tyler Newbin, self-explanatory. They need a safety, and look, he's just a really good safety, and I think he'll work in multitudes of schemes. He's not that man coverage guy, but ultimately, I think he'll just help you out, you know, in general, because he's a very smart safety. On to the Minnesota Vikings here at 42, we're going Leonard Taylor III. And imagine the explosiveness. You got Dallas Turner and Leonard Taylor on this defensive line. Dude, that's a tough one to block for any offensive line. The amount of explosiveness and athleticism that they now have on their defensive line. So Leonard Taylor, a lot of upside. Just got to untap that, you know, build that up and see what you can do. On to the Baltimore Ravens here, Enos Rakestraw Jr. with their first pick. He falls a little bit because of the injuries, but the talent is all there with Enos Rakestraw Jr. If he would have just, you know, been more consistent. I know he did ACL tear 2 in 2021 or somewhere in that time frame. A little banged up this season too, but on film, the dude is a lockdown corner. And the Baltimore Ravens could get a little younger in the cornerback room. Brandon Stevens going to the last year of his deal as well. On to the Raiders. We're going with Christian Haynes, guard, UConn. Right guard upgrade there. Well, long-term replacement. You got to figure on Greg Van Roten, get a little bit older, so you get a right guard of the future. And then you got Chris Jenkins, Michigan defensive tackle, to be that running mate with Brian Brzee, to be the run stopper, to pair along with Brian Brzee and his athletic upside as a pass rusher. And I mean, Chris Jenkins is no schnob as an athlete either. He's on Bruce Feldman's freaks list, so I imagine he's going to test out very well. You got an elite interior defense line building there, hopefully. TJ Tampa, you know, Chris Ballard loves them tools, loves them, you know, physical traits, and TJ Tampa definitely has those physical traits. So Juju Brentson, TJ Tampa, that's a scary, monstrous length duo. Then we go on to Xavier Leggett for the New York Giants, getting themselves a playmaker on the outside. So we were trying to help the trenches with our two first picks, and now we had a playmaker on the outside for Daniel Jones. I think Xavier Leggett's being a little overlooked right now, but really do like Xavier Leggett and his talent. Then we go on to a next trade, and the Cleveland Browns are going to be moving up here for somebody, but I'll keep you in suspense for as long as possible. Pardon the interruption, but how's the weather doing? We're going to give up 155 to move up with Jacksonville for Xavier Worthy, that elite speed that he has, that Zay Flowers type of effect of last draft. I think he can be something like that. And this Cleveland Browns team, they need that into this offense. That's what they're missing, I feel like. So Xavier Worthy, I felt like was worth the pun intended, the pick to move up here. On to the Cincinnati Bengals, because I might have selected him here too for the Bengals, so that's why trying to jump the division rival. But we're going to take Rook or row, row, row your boat coming over to this interior defensive line, and he helps them out. I think he's going to be shooting up gaps like crazy. Really nice athlete. He can just help out this team and run defense too. I think he's a good block shedder. And ultimately, they need interior defense line for the future because B.J. Hill's getting older. D.J. Reed is a free agent too. So we'll see what happens there. I need to get a little younger on to pair along, at least with Zach Carter, give him some competition. On to the Philadelphia Eagles, Edrin Cooper, one that I do every single week. Self-explanatory, they need a linebacker. They might need a couple of linebackers. We shall see. Cameron Kitchens. And the Pittsburgh Steelers are going to be cooking up something here now with Minkah Fitzpatrick, Cameron Kitchens, two uber-versatile defensive backs into their secondary. You can shuffle these guys around, and you got two ball hawks, man. That's gonna be scary in your back end secondary. Yeah, absolutely. On to the Los Angeles Rams. I'm going Renardo Green. Definitely a dude that hopefully starts getting some attention. I think he is, but for good reason. He is a guy that it was put out on an island a lot. And he thrived against the best wide receivers out, really, in, you know, that he went up against Malik Nabers. And I thought his tape against Malik Nabers was better than anybody. So Renardo Green, definitely a guy to keep an eye out on, and comes in here, gives them an upgrade right away, I think. And then we go on to Chris Braswell. Edge rusher slash, you know, hybrid outside linebacker. Chris Braswell, somebody that comes in for Vic Fangio, gives him another pass rusher for the future to pair along there, you know, with the Reddick, Nolan Smith, etc. You got to figure Brandon Graham going to be a free agent next year. Josh Sweat as well. So trying to get another edge rusher, just kind of, it's a BPA approach too. I felt like he was the best available. Then we go on to the Jacksonville Jaguars after the trade down. Michael Hall Jr., a defensive interior lineman from the Ohio State University. They need some juice on the interior. They need a pass rusher. I think that's something that they're missing. So I'm going to go Michael Hall here. I think that he is one of the better pass rushers on the interior of the defensive line. Yeah, he's not the greatest run defender, right? But I think he's going to be a nice piece for this team, especially Devon Hamilton getting healthy next season, trying to improve this interior front. And you got Walker and you got Allen, who should be back, and I'd be shocked if he isn't. But now you got yourself an interior player to go along with those guys. Mason Smith, we're going to keep with interior defense lineman Mason Smith from LSU. I feel like he's being a little underrated right now. The dude is a really good prospect from LSU, and coming off that ACL injury, a little bit slow to start out the season, and started flashing at the end of the season big time. And I think he's got all the talent to be a big time interior presence for whichever team lands him. And this Raiders team, they need some help. They were trying to move Tyree Wilson to the inside. I mean, for other reasons too, but they need help, and they need to get younger on the interior defense line. Adam Butler's a free agent. So, you know, you got to figure on that they're going to need some more help and some more beef. You know, John Jenkins getting a little bit older. He's also a free agent too. Then we go on to Junior Colson, linebacker from Michigan, the Wolverine. And he's a great run defender, man. He's just a really smart dude, instinctual linebacker. Maybe not your elite speed guy, but very sound linebacker. Is going to help this team out day one. Then we go on to the Bucks, Peyton Wilson. Another linebacker is going to help out a team day one, because you got to figure on Devin White. I don't know if he's going to get, you know, stay back here with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. We shall see. But for the time being, they've got two linebackers, Lavonte David and Devin White, both free agents. Peyton Wilson could be an immediate starter for this team. Zach Frazier, West Virginia center. But I think he could also play guard early on. And if you don't bring back Josh Myers, then Zach Frazier can end up being your center replacement for the future. But helping out your offensive line here with Zach Frazier. On to the Houston Texans, I'm going Jermaine Burton. Really good route runner. He's smooth in and out of his breaks. He's explosive in and out of his breaks. And he had another playmaker. Maybe Tank Dell needs a little bit of time. So making sure CJ Stroud has all the tools. And with John Metchie, too, is another piece to go along with Nico Collins. Then we go on to Javon Bullard. Safety, Georgia. Pretty self-explanatory for the Buffalo team. Need to get a little younger and get more secondary players in that back end. On to Marshawn Nealand for the Detroit Lions, a guy with a lot of upside, man. He gives me some Brandon Graham vibes. He's got that power move, and he's able to, you know, bend the edge enough, right? He's got enough bend to be able to get around the edge, and he's got a great frame, too. 6'3". He's got, like, 34-inch arms, 260 pounds. Really nice edge prospect from Western Michigan to keep an eye out. I think this is an immense value, too, for the Detroit Lions. You pair him along with Kool-Aid McKistry, building some defense. And then we go on to Patrick Paul, offensive tackle. Now, the only question I would have with this pick is, can Patrick Paul play right tackle? Because Morgan Moses is a free agent next year. And you need a swing tackle in general early on, because you got some injuries, right? You especially were injured this last season. Now, Patrick McCarry is still under contract, but McCarry can also play guard too. So he gives you a lot of versatility. Patrick Paul can be a developmental piece. And for a team like Baltimore, they do a pretty good job of investing in the offensive line and thinking about the future here. And that is what this pick is with Patrick Paul, whether it's a right tackle of the future, or, you know, like I said, if Ronnie Stanley does have some more injury struggles, then Patrick Paul can hold down that left tackle spot. We go on to Cooper Beebe, more offensive line, but this time for the 49ers, they get themselves a guard, and you could try him at left or right guard, or, you know, left guard, move Aaron Banks over to right guard, figure it out, but Cooper Beebe helps them out. Obviously, that was one of their biggest weaknesses in the Super Bowl, with Chris Jones tearing it up. I mean, Chris Jones is Chris Jones. On to Braden Fisk, a guy from Florida State. They're going back to Florida State, the Kansas City Chiefs are, and they're going to get an interior disruptor with the elite first step, and to help out if you do lose Chris Jones, and you're going to really need help, but if you pair him along with Chris Jones, I think that would be a mad combination. He's a great run defender. With that first step, he is going to be really a problem for guards to handle. I'm just telling you right now, really fun prospect to watch. The third round, we're going back to Rome. And what we do in life echoes in eternity. Well, that's one of the great, that's one of my favorite movies of all time, Gladiator. But Roman Wilson is going to be the pick here for the Michigan or the Carolina Panthers from Michigan, the Wolverine, and he gives them a playmaker for Bryce Young. We add offensive line, add that playmaker, and hopefully this offense can get going this next season. Roger Rosengarten, right tackle for the Arizona Cardinals. This team, you got to figure on Paris Johnson, moves over to the left tackle position this season, especially with the fact that you may have to move on from DJ Humphries or with the injury late. You're going to need a right tackle, whether that's free agency to step in day one. But Roger Rosengarten, I think he's a guy that can step in day one. At least competes there at the right tackle position, and now you got yourself a bookend tackle duo. On to the Washington Commanders, Braylon Trice, edge rusher. So we get that that uber upside athletic traits guy with Chop Robinson. Then we also get a really solid base kind of floor dude with Braylon Trice. And I'm not trying to scuff at Braylon Trice. He's a good edge rusher, man, from Washington. The guy has got good power, and he's going to get you with that bull rush. And so you get a good combination of speed rush and bull rush off your two edges. This team needs to rebuild the edge room. Now we go on to the New England Patriots, and they're going Karun Amangaji from Yale, the tackle, left tackle. He also played guard, too, but he comes in and is a developmental left tackle and helps you out tremendously to protect your quarterback and Michael Penix Jr. or whoever, right? I mean, if Mac Jones early on and then Michael Penix Jr. will probably end up winning down. Hey, Mac Jones isn't terrible, I'll be real. I don't think Mac Jones is as bad as people put him out to be. This team has not been a very talented football team for a little bit. You got to add more talent into this room and stuff like that. But overall, Karun Amangaji protecting your quarterback. Then we go on to Jurtavian Sanders, tight end, should I say? I don't know. I was trying to find the words for it. I'm like, say it. I was in my mind. I'm like, Porky Pig. That's all, folks. But Jurtavian Sanders, tight end from Texas, Hook 'em Horns, getting themselves a tight end for the future with Gerald Everett being a free agent. Then we go on to Austin Booker, uber athletic upside edge rusher from Kansas. This guy just needs to build out his frame, only be 240 pounds right now, but he's got 34-inch arms, 6'4", the size and the frame, athleticism to be a real menace. If he can put it together, has all the tools to be a true number one style of edge rusher, and he gets the Max Crosby comps for a very good reason, because he kind of looks like him. He just needs to bulk up and build up his frame. So you take a chance here, you get your interior player slash, you know, hybrid dude with Darius Robinson, and now you add in more depth to go along with Zeez Ojulari with the injuries and etc. They need more pass rush in general. Then we go on to the Arizona Cardinals, Jeremiah Trotter Jr., linebacker from Clemson, somebody that I'm a huge fan of. Yes, he doesn't have the size speed that maybe you want in the linebacker position nowadays, but he's just a good player. I'm not passing on him. I know he's down on lower on a lot of boards, but to me, very good linebacker prospect. He just knows how to play the linebacker position, and the Arizona Cardinals, they need a good linebacker. We go on to the Jets, Jalen McMillan, one of my favorite picks here for the Jets. I'm a huge Jalen McMillan fan, so it might be a little biased, but he also just felt, I don't force picks, I really don't. I really try not to, at least. I really don't. Jalen McMillan, Washington wide receiver, good route runner, good separator, especially the short, intermediate ranges. I'd like to see him maybe improve his, you know, elite ball skills down the field. I don't know if that's his game, but you got Garrett Wilson. So I'm feeling good that you're adding in another playmaker in here to this offense and offensive line help too with Amarius Mims. We go into Christian Mahogany, offensive line help here for the Detroit Lions. He is an immediate starter for them at right guard, in my opinion. I think he can be an immediate starter at the right guard position. Very strong, very powerful. He's going to open up even more lanes for that running back tandem with Montgomery and Gibbs. Then we go on to Ricky Pearsall, wide receiver from Florida to the Baltimore Ravens. They add another playmaker to go along with Zay Flowers. And Ricky Pearsall, really good route runner, helps out this team in Lamar Jackson. They did bring back Nelson Aguilar, I believe. They just recently re-signed him. However, they could still use some more help in that receiving core. And on to the Bears. With Eddie Jackson getting cut, you got to figure on safety of the future. Jaden Hicks has all the talent, all the tools, great size. good athleticism can play in multitude of schemes. And somebody that comes into this room improving tackling, you know, is definitely going to be a priority for Jaden Hicks. But I don't see why this guy can't be a really good safety at the next level. Oh, and a young prospect too. Cole Bishop, safety from Utah. We're going back-to-back safety. And the Denver Broncos go get themselves a safety as well. You got to figure on that they're going to have to think about the future too with their safety room. Justin Simmons getting a little bit older, getting more cheaper, or getting more expensive and whatnot. I mean, you keep Justin Simmons, but who's that number two guy? Because Caden Stern's been injured a lot. And, you know, P.J. Locke, good rotational player, and I think he can start for this team. But you figure on for the future, Cole Bishop, I think he's a really good prospect and a good value at this point. Spencer Rattler, the Rattler, takes his position here for the Las Vegas Raiders. They get themselves a quarterback to at least add some competition with Aiden O'Connell. Even though I like Aiden O'Connell, I think he can be the starter. But Spencer Rattler, I think he's got a lot of upside too, and somebody that I do feel like is a little underrated and very much should be in the conversation with those top six quarterbacks. He, absolutely. I think there's like a top seven quarterbacks in this class that I really do like in this round three or higher range. Then we go on to the Giants back on the clock with the trade pick that they got, and they're going to get Max Melton, adding to the secondary some more. You get Deontay Banks and Max Melton, hopefully to be your outside cornerback duo, and, you know, Cordell Flott in the slot. So it even rhymes. I love Max Melton too. And then you got Jalen Polk, wide receiver from Washington. So, you know, add another playmaker on with Drake London. And, you know, maybe ideally I would have liked to add somebody with some speed here on the outside. But I just felt like Jalen Polk was the best available. He fell here. And so I'm like, I can't pass up on good receiving talent, great ball skills, and add some more possession into this offense for J.J. McCarthy. Then we go on to Chris Abrams-Drain, cornerback from Mississippi, Missouri. And he's got that tenacious ability, even despite his size being 5'11", 173. Good length, though, on his arm. You know, he's got good arm length. And really sticky coverage corner. Somebody that comes into the Bengals and ends up being the Mike Hilton replacement of the future. Then we go on to the Seattle Seahawks. They're going Dominic Pooney here. Former left tackle at Kansas, but played at all three positions, actually, at the Senior Bowl. But I see him more as a guard at the next level. And you put him in there. If Damian Lewis does end up walking in free agent, because he's getting expected to get a huge contract in free agency, which is definitely a possibility, Dominic Pooney helps him out much needed. And hey, if not, give competition for Ole Olabatimi at the center position too. So they need offense help in general on their offensive line. Protect your quarterback and Jane Daniels. That's another priority. Then we go on to the Indianapolis Colts going Cedric Van Praan. And you got to think Ryan Kelly going into the last year of his contract. He's very expensive. So getting a little bit older now, Cedric Van Praan can be a nice developmental piece, because to me, he is a developmental guy. I don't think he's a day one starter. Just watching this film, I see him more as a later day three guy, a later day two guy that develops behind a center for a season and then takes that role. I mean, he's got all the starting capabilities, just needs time. Then we go on to Blake Fisher, more offensive line here. We're getting a run, but Blake Fisher maybe be the right tackle, even left tackle. He has experience at left tackle too, so he can give Aldrick Jackson some competition and be long-term Rob Havenstein replacement, because he's going to need time, man. He needs some development for sure. I feel like this season was very up and down for him, man. Like, it was really up and down season for Blake Fisher. His state game was really good, but there was some bad film too on his tape. We go on to Christian Jones, another right tackle here, and the offensive line theme continues. But Christian Jones, great right tackle to be that long-term right tackle for this team. You move Broderick Jones back over to left tackle, and hopefully, you know, with this offensive line, we reworked it. Jackson Powers Johnson center, and Broderick Jones left tackle, Christian Jones right tackle. So you got the Joneses, you got the Johnson, Jackson, you got the J's everywhere, man. It's a offensive line rebuilt. Then we go on to the Cleveland Browns here. Brandon Dorlus to be an interior player for this team. They need a pass rusher on that interior next to Dalvin Tomlinson. We go on to the Houston Texans, Dwight McLaughlin. And what a name for a cornerback, McLaughlin. He's, I think Brochman calls him the glove or whatever. But anyway, that's a good one. But McLaughlin comes in and adds another off-cover corner for this, D'Amico Ryan's secondary in with Derek Stingley to be a nice duo of the future. And then we go on to Jonathan Brooks, running back from Texas, keeping it local. And Jonathan Brooks, a lot of upside, man. I think he would be the top running back if it weren't for the ACL injury. And Jerry Jones pounces here on the running back position for the future. And then we go on to with the Green Bay Packers, Adisa Isaac, which is BPA. Honestly, he should not fall to this point. I have him as a second round pick. I really do. I think Adisa Isaac's a really phenomenal talent. Just kind of, you know, sometimes you showcase other edge rushers or whatever the reason may be. Adisa Isaac, though, super talented, really good football player. And I see him in two seasons being a very good, if nothing else, rotational player. We go on to Malachi Corley, wide receiver from Western Kentucky for the Buccaneers. They got to figure on if Mike Evans doesn't get a deal. I'm not saying this is the one-to-one replacement, but he adds a playmaker into their room. We go on to number 90 and Mason McCormick. And I'm not talking about the seasonings, but bam, Emerald. But we're going to go and get a left guard here and somebody that, you know, Elijah Wilkerson is a free agent. They need a left guard of the future. This dude has been uber reliable, played left guard for 5 seasons and like hasn't missed a game or whatever. Like the dude has some of the most experience in this class. And then back up with the Packers here. We're going at linebacker this time. We're going to go Cedric Gray and somebody. I'm a big fan of Cedric Gray. I think he's got all the tools to be a really good linebacker, whether it's coverage, around the line of scrimmage. He needs some more development for sure, but I see why this guy can't, you know, even make an immediate impact for a team. But he can sit behind Devondre Campbell for a season, and then he ends up being that duo with Quay Walker as a really athletic combination. Then we go on to number 92. Javon Baker, underrated wide receiver, in my opinion, from UCF. He's got great hands, man. Really good hands. You know, his drop rate is over 10%, like, over the past 2 years. Like, I think his hands are really good. From where the tape that I watched, I thought his hands were pretty good. So, he had a couple of tough drops, but, man, everyone has a couple of tough drops. He's got good athleticism, too. So, I think he can be that outside receiver for this team in the future. And then we go on to the third-round pick for the Baltimore Ravens, or their second third-round pick, and it's going to be Mekhi Wingo. They need some more interior help, and you give a little bit of competition for Broderick Washington with Mekhi Wingo, interior defensive lineman from LSU. He's low, got that center of gravity, got good pop on contact, can even play off the edge if you want him to do that. We go into Mike Sanders still for the 49ers, getting themselves a slot corner of the future. You got to figure on, too, this is another area that they're going to have to start looking at. All their cornerbacks are basically free agents. We need to look at that with Mike Sanders still, a really talented slot corner there. And the Wolverines, he's also feisty as a run defender, too. He's got some monster hits despite his size and definitely can make some plays. We go on to Johnny. Here's Johnny Wilson now. And Johnny Wilson is going to be the pick for, we got three Florida State picks for the Kansas City Chiefs. That wasn't intended. It really wasn't. But the way it worked, Johnny Wilson, though, gives you another playmaker into this room for Patrick Mahomes. And I feel like he can be a tight end with some development. So he's going to need a year or two of development. Like, I think that's what he's going to need. But he has all the upside to be, the next Darren Waller type of prospect. On to the Jacksonville Jaguars, Jerrion Jones, another underrated, Florida State, they've got some underrated prospects there. Fabian Lovett's a good one too. But Jerrion Jones, slot corner, he was another dude that was a lockdown for this team. So Jerrion Jones comes in here to be the developmental slot for this team and long-term replacement for Trey Herndon. And then on to the Eagles, last pick of this mock draft, we're going with Blake Corum, running back from Michigan. We're going to go add a running back because DeAndre Swift is a free agent, and there's a good chance that he prices out Howie Roseman and the contract that he wants in the offseason that he's earned. So Blake Corum will end up being the team's running back of the future. We go on to number 98, Jonah Ellis, another guy that kind of fell. And I like Jonah Ellis. He's a really crafty pass rusher. He knows how to use his hands, get after the quarterback. And the 49ers, they love the pass rushers. So, and there's a good chance that they're probably not going to bring back Chase Young. So Jonah Ellis gives him some more help to go along with Drake Jackson and maybe, you know, some more depth that they can bring in free agency. Next pick for the Buffalo Bills, Walter Ruse, Oklahoma, left tackle. And he's somebody that's got extraordinary length, enough athleticism to get the job done. But I think he can be a great developmental left tackle behind Deion Dawkins for a season and then hopefully take that role if you do have to lose him or if nothing else, gives you a great swing tackle. And then on to the Rams, comp pick in the third round. We're going with Kalen Bullock, safety from USC. Falls just, you know, because of the size, you know, or the run support concerns, right? He's got to get better as a tackler. He's got to get stronger as a tackler. So he's going to be, you know, a little scheme specific for some teams. But Bullock gives him some much needed secondary help and at least gives him competition with Rush Yeast in the back end. And you also have Jordan Fuller, who's a free agent too. So they're going to need a little bit more help in the secondary. We go on to Bucky Irvin, running back from Oregon. And I had to kind of, you know, put some thought to this one, but I felt like, hey, add a receiving back, somebody that I think is going to add some more flair to this offense and a great 1-2 punch to go along with Brian Robinson. I love that combination. So add another playmaker in this case scenario with a Bucky Irvin. On to round number 4, the final round of this mock draft. We're going with the Carolina Panthers, Justin Aboigbe, as I can't spell correctly. That is a typo, so pardon me. But anyway, Justin Aboigbe, Alabama defensive tackle. Can play, honestly, anywhere. He can even play off the edge. He did play off the edge for Alabama. But they need some interior help on that Carolina Panthers team to go along with Derrick Brown. And I think he could be that pass rusher, too, to help them. We go on to Jarvis Brownlee Jr., formerly of Florida State, but a Louisville safety for the Washington Commanders, getting some more help. You got to figure on Kendall Fuller, also a free agent. So you added more competition, Brownlee, you got Emmanuel Forbes, and you go from there. We go on to the New England Patriots and Muhammad Kamara, Colorado State edge rusher, and somebody that this team, Josh Uche's a free agent, and Matthew Judon getting a little bit older. They don't have much depth off the edge. So Muhammad Kamara, with that speed rush that he has off to bend the edge, gets you some more pass rush. And then Braylon Allen, running back to the Arizona Cardinals to finish up their draft. We're going to add maybe the James Conner of the future. And I think he can develop into that type of guy. Actually, he's got decent hands like James Conner does at his size. We go on to the Chargers at 106, Audric Estime. This team has been looking for a good pure runner for so long. I think Audric Estime is that guy that they've been looking for. I think they can finally find that with Audric Estime. Really good running football player. I don't know, it quite makes sense. We go on to Kalen King. He falls, and it's for good reason. His tape has not been good this season. He struggled tremendously at the Senior Bowl, couldn't cover anybody. But I still think the talent is there with Kalen King to take a chance on day three. So for the Tennessee Titans, need some more secondary help. Take the chance here with Kalen King with this fourth round pick. This is another one that I can't believe he fell this far. He really should not. He's a round three guy. Trey Benson falls to the New York Giants. And they go ahead, and if Saquon Barkley is not re-signed, you're going to need a running back to replace him, at least to give competition with Eric Gray. Trey Benson can definitely do that right here. So this was one that I screamed into the board, and like, yes, booyah, man. Even if Saquon Barkley was back, I'd still go ahead and draft Trey Benson. The value is too good. On to the Minnesota Vikings, Bo Limmer, center of the future, to get to learn behind Garrett Bradbury for his season. You got to figure maybe you can try to upgrade there, at least give him a push. And also, Bo Limmer can play guard as well. So if you don't bring back Dalton Reisner, then Bo Limmer can compete at the left guard position too. We go on to the Atlanta Falcons. I'm going McKinley Jackson, interior defense lineman from Texas A&M, to give you some more youth on the interior, because they are getting a little bit older now. So you figure on Grady Jarrett, David Onyemata, and then also Calais Campbell being a free agent this year. McKinley Jackson could be a nice interior player of the future for them. Kingsley Egukon from Florida, center, can be a developmental prospect. And you're probably going to have to bring in a free agent in this case scenario. It would be a day one starter. But Egukon has all the upside. He's got the traits, man, like the athleticism and the size profile is really good. It's a day two type of profile. Even, you know, it's really good, man. It really is. He's got the adequate length. He's got power. But I think his overall feet aren't always connected with his hands. And he gets real top heavy at times and loses his balance. So if he can work on some of those things, I think he can be a really good center down the line. Evan Anderson, Florida Atlantic interior defensive lineman, can kind of be like, maybe this team's Grover Stewart. Like, that's what I'm hoping. Him next to Quentin Williams, just kind of be that space eater run defender. That's what we need on our defensive line. Raiders are going to go get Brendan Rice here, wide receiver from USC. Just give you that fourth, fifth wide receiver. You know, you've got to figure on Hunter Renfrow. Maybe he's not back. There's a possibility. So maybe Trey Tucker steps in. Brendan Rice can give you some more help. They need to get a little cheaper at some point at the receiver position. And another playmaker for your quarterback or quarterbacks, and Spencer Rattler and AOC. We go on to Trayvon Wallace for the Jets. Back on the clock here. So we're adding a developmental linebacker because C.J. Mosley, Quincy Williams, both going to be eventual free agents 2025. So finding some youth here to go along with Sherwood can help them here with Trayvon Wallace, with the upside that he has with his athleticism. Next pick, Zach Zinter, guard, right guard for the Jacksonville Jaguars of the future. He can develop a season behind Brandon Scherff and be the long-term right guard. And then we go on to Malik Washington, wide receiver from Virginia. And Virginia produces some good wide receivers, man, of late. And Malik Washington could be the next in line. I really am a huge fan of Malik Washington. Super shifty. Doesn't have elite long speed, but he gets open and he's got great ball skills. And he can be that long-term replacement for Tyler Boyd in the slot. We go on to Kitten Oladapo, safety from Oregon State, an underrated player here as well. I feel like somebody that can at least compete into that safety room early on. And I actually think he could start early on too. He's a guy that has the size profile, a good athleticism too for his size. Him and Andre Sisco can be a really formidable duo for the future. On to Tez Walker, wide receiver from North Carolina. Give you a little more competition with Alec Pierce. I think he can fit that Z mold for this team. And as I was talking about, just give you a little bit of a push with Alec Pierce. So if Alec Pierce does take that next step, great. But if not, then Tez Walker can hopefully give you that needed push at the outside for Anthony Richardson. the iceberg. Tommy Eichenberg, too good of a value for me at this point for the Seahawks to get themselves some help at the linebacker position, at least a combination with Jordan Brooks, because you figure Brooks probably going to be back on a contract extension, but Bobby Wagner, I don't know, right? So Eichenberg to pair along in this new Mike McDonald defense. We go on to Maurice Louifau from Notre Dame for the linebacker of the future for the Pittsburgh Steelers. I think he's got all the tools as well. A guy with 34-inch arms and good size, almost 240 pounds, 6'2". And he's a ferocious dude, man. He looks to lay a hit, and he's got that physical mentality of the steel curtain that you're looking for, even though that's, you know, defensive line. But I'm just saying, the steel mentality there, Pittsburgh steel, I think he gives me those vibes. On to their next pick here, which is next, Josh Newton. Big Newton's going to come in and play the slot corner position of the future, as I talked about in the Pittsburgh Steeler video. I think that maybe you move Patrick Peterson inside of the slot, and you have Josh Newton to develop here into the slot for the future, and or he can play on the outside, but maybe with his speed concerns, it depending on how well he tested the combine, you move him inside to the slot. We're also going cornerback for the Denver Broncos. We're taking DJ James, a guy that I'm a huge fan of his film. It just comes down to the size concerns. Not everybody's going to like that size, and it's not going to be for everybody in their cup of tea. But DJ James, for me, really good corner, sticky in coverage, and you're adding some more help in here for the Baltimore Ravens, and hopefully can be that long-term pairing with Patrick Surtain and Riley Moss or something like that. You can figure it out, and you also have Jaquan McMillan who can, you know, rock the slot. You got on to our next pick, Gabriel Murphy, UCLA edge rusher. Wasn't able to get an edge rusher early here for the Bears, and I also felt like there was some other needs we went after. Ultimately, though, Murphy gives you some juice and maybe bringing somebody else to in free agency. However, Gabriel Murphy is no slouch to be looking. I mean, the dude's a really good pass rusher at UCLA. Doesn't quite get the credit because you got Leatu Latu on the other side, but the Murphy brothers, they're very talented. And if nothing else, I think he'd be a great situational pass rusher for this Bears team. Now we go on to the ship, Will Shipley. One of my guys in this, I'm a huge Will Shipley fan. He's super explosive, man. I don't know what it is about Will Shipley, but I'm a huge fan. Very, very explosive back. And I don't think Clemson's offensive line did him favors a lot, especially in the 2022 season. And he's a good receiving guy. Like, I think he could be a great receiving back, get the ball in space. Will Shipley can make dudes miss with his flying ability. On to Tyler Davis, and what a great name too, but Tyler Davis here for the San Francisco 49ers, going to give them some much needed depth slash the future. You got to figure on Arik Armstead is a free agent in 2025, so finding at least some more depth is going to be critical. And also you got to look at the fact that Kinlaw is a free agent this year too, so finding maybe a rotational player if you aren't able to retain Javon Kinlaw. And then on to the Bucs here. They're going quarterback Michael Pratt. And I had no relation to Chris Pratt, but anyway, Michael Pratt, quarterback from Tulane, gets you a quarterback to back up your quarterback in Baker Mayfield, who I imagine is going to get an extension, but will he get a massive extension? That's a good question. But Michael Pratt, at least you take a chance on a quarterback if Baker's contract is only like a one-year deal or something like that. So, or a developmental quarterback of the future, if nothing else, a good backup to have. Kamani Vidal to the Green Bay Packers, getting themselves a running back here to pair along with Aaron Jones, at least early on. And then Vidal can be the two guy early and then ultimately, hopefully, be the team's number one after Aaron Jones, you know, free agent next year if he's unable to be retained. But Kamani Vidal, also a really explosive back in that 20-yard distance. Like, he's got some really good burst at the hole, and I think he'll fit nicely into this Packers offense. And then we go on to the Houston Texans, Malik Mustafa, safety from Wake Forest, getting some more help because Jamie Ward is going to be getting a little bit older now, and you got to figure on he's going to be going to a contract year, and you need more help in that safety room. It struggled tremendously at times this season, and it could even be a higher need than this, but Mustafa has all that potential to be that uber versatile playmaker to go along with Jalen Petrie. We go on to Javon Solomon, edge rusher from Troy. Very interesting build at 6 foot, 247 pounds. Got uber great length too. Got like 34-inch arms. So he's a guy that at least gets you a rotational player on with Leonard Floyd being a free agent. Maybe prices you out. You only able to bring back one of those guys between him and AJ Epineza. So Solomon could be a rotational player, and Von Miller is probably more of a rotation player anyway at this point too. On to Skull Nation for their final pick. I'm going Andrew Phillips, Kentucky cornerback. He's a really feisty corner, man, and he was very sticky in the Senior Bowl. I believe he was 5 for 5 in all of his reps. But Andrew Phillips gets you some more help, and maybe you can hit like Blockman, you know, sort of thing. Like, just try to take another stab at the cornerback position. He can definitely play man coverage at the next level. On to the Ravens here, and they're going to be going with All Day Ray. Ray Davis from Kentucky. really fun fit here for the Ravens. I think this would be a dream fit for Ray Davis. Come in here to be the replacement for Gus Edwards. If he ends up walking in free agency slash Keaton Mitchell coming off the injury, is going to need some time more than likely. So Ray Day gets you some more help on that that running back room. Now we go on to the 49ers. Matt Congalaves from Pittsburgh. From Pittsburgh, the tackle. And he has ability to play left tackle and right tackle, but he can maybe develop there behind Colt McKivitz for a season or something like that. At least give him some competition. Maybe I should have gone right tackle a little bit earlier, but kind of the way the board went, just kind of shake things up a little bit for the Niners. You know, I always kind of go in the same fact. And I think there's a lot of different ways that this team could go. Maybe go free agent right tackle. So there's a lot of different avenues. So maybe you go draft here later on. And, you know, Matt's a good offensive lineman too. If nothing else, a good swing tackle there from Pittsburgh. On to Kyree Jackson, cornerback from Oregon. And here's a guy with immense length, right? He's got that size profile that some teams are just going to salivate over, man. He's that long and physical corner on the outside. So you get him in here to add more competition. And you got to figure on Joshua Williams. Jalen Watson's also a free agent, I believe. Now, Joshua Williams still under contract. But Kyree Jackson can maybe be that third corner to go along with Joshua Williams. Final pick of the draft, Isaiah Adams. We're going to take a guard for the Baltimore Ravens here, left guard. I think he's more of a guard at the next level than a tackle. I just don't think he has the foot speed, which is fine, right? We got our tackle on Patrick Paul. Now let's add an interior player. We'll see if Andrew Voorhees is ready to go, or Ben Cleveland even too, but they're going to need some more help on the interior of the offensive line with John Simpson and also Kevin Zeiler both being free agents. So at least thinking about the future, if they just retain one of them, no matter what, they're going to need some help. That is going to do it here for this four-round mock draft. Let me know what you think, agree or disagree. What did I do as it is to getting dark and spooky? Anyway, I hope you guys have a really good day. My name is GSLING. I'm doing my thing. I'll talk to you real soon.